Everyone, and welcome to today's session, which, as you can see from the title, is a bit different. And like I do mention to us during our sessions that you shouldn't limit yourself to one tool, and cloud is becoming a platform, not a tool. Everybody is expecting you to be cloud aware, cloud literate. And today we are having another session that's aimed at helping you to be aware of the bigger platform tools that are on the data side of the cloud. So it will be an end-to-end data engineering project using Databricks and Data Factory. And our speaker is Temi Dayomoni. So I'll quickly do the introduction and get out of the way so I can give him all the time he needs to take us on the demo he's prepared for us. If you check in the chat area, he has put the working document, the demo file. Temila, if you can help share it again, just in case people who are not part of the chat who just joined, they will be able to see. So this session is brought to you by your BizEdge and the MHS. Your BizEdge, I mean, it's we're a Microsoft Excel data analysis and Power BI business intelligence consulting and solutions firm. So we render training and consulting. I'm sure you've probably heard this again and again, but I always try to make sure I mention that we are different in our methodology. You know, we focus more on quality and continuous training. Yeah, so nobody can learn this thing in just 3 days class, 4 days class, 5 days class. And we've tried all kinds of approaches, and we found out that the sustainable way, the right way to actually give people that value for their money and that authentic learning experience is a continuous learning process. Webinars, after training tasks, engaging them in events, making sure that whatever they learn, they have the opportunity to keep practicing it and being aware of what is new. So that's our own training methodology, and that's why this event is happening. It's originally designed for our training participants, but we decided to, you know, throw it open to everyone. And MHS is our sister company in the USA, no, Canada. So if you have any persons who, you know, they are outside of Nigeria and they are looking to take training, it might be easier based on time zone, based on payment, based on whatsoever factors that the MHS and other Canadian entities, the one they will prefer to engage. And for consulting services for foreign clients, we take them up via this Canadian entity. Okay, so I forgot to change the image. Okay, apologies. So the image you are seeing is not the image that should be there. Let me just take it out. Yeah. So Temidayo Omoni is the, well, I will later in my announce, but up until now, right, he works with us at your BizEdge and he's actually in charge of our data engineering. So both on the consulting content internal project side, and he's always doing a lot of stuff with Power Platform. I forgot to even include that here. Power Platform and Power BI, Python. He's got over 3 years experience in this analytics domain. He enjoys teaching, sharing his knowledge. He's a technical writer on many international platforms. He's an active member of a lot of data science groups. So I'm going to share his X account. You know, it used to be Twitter now, but X. So I'm going to share his Twitter account. That's like the easiest way to engage him, you know, be aware of what he's up to. So I'll do that. And then right now I'm going to hand over to Temidaya. So Temidaya, you can, you know, take over the screen share and
Okay.
take us away.
Okay. Thank you, Michael. I don't know. Am I audible enough? Because it's okay. It's really bad today.
Yes, you're audible, yes.
Okay. Let me try share my screen. Okay. Because of time, I was actually rushing, so I didn't even make a slide. I just had to make something now. Okay. So in the group. In the group chats, right, the chat box, I've dropped a link for all the material we'll be using today. So we're going to be using more of Azure environment. So we're using more of Azure Databricks and Azure Data. So In the group chat, right, the chat box, I've dropped a link for all the material we'll be using today. So we're going to be using more of Azure environment. So we'll be using more of Azure Databricks and Azure Data Factory. So this is just a simple architecture of what I plan doing, but this is not actually the main thing. This is just something very simple. So it's just more like different steps, right? So the first thing I want to do is I actually have a data storage system where I'm going to be storing different random files. And the blob storage system is called the Azure Data Lake Gen 2. So the advantage of the Data Lake Gen 2 is that it can store any kind of data, both structured, unstructured, and semi-structured data. So the idea is I take data, I dump it inside my Azure Data Lake Gen 2. So as soon as I dump it, right, I use my Azure Databricks, which is a notebook, right, which is created by Apache Spark, to do all my data transformation. So the idea is I dump different data into my Azure Data Lake. I connect my Azure Databricks to my Azure Data Lake Gen 2. I do all my data transformation and I push it into a structural database, more like a data warehouse, right? But all of this will be done inside of Azure Databricks. So when I'm done with everything, because you have to automate the entire process, you have to create a pipeline. So the idea is I will now use Azure Data Factory to actually automate the entire process by creating a trigger. So it's going to be an event-based trigger. I know this is going to be, today's going to be a lot of coding and scripting and everything. So I don't want to really do much presentation. Let's just go down into the today's business, right? Okay. So I'll open my browser. So I'm using the Microsoft Azure environment. So if you open your Azure portal for the first time, right? You go to your resources. So one of my resources is called Azure Databricks. Right. So when you go there, you just click on launch workspace. So when you launch the workspace, it opens over here. So let's give it a couple of minutes. So I have to log in with my credentials. So it's going to sign me in and everything. Okay. Okay, cool. So now before you sign, okay, if you're using the premium, I'm actually using Azure Databricks premium account. So it's kind of a little bit different, right? So one cool thing is you have to, before you start working on your Databricks or your Spark, you have to have what you call a cluster. So a cluster is just more like a compute engine, right? So this is what drives your entire codes and everything. So I've actually created a cluster here. So if I go to my cluster, I actually have different clusters for different things, but I'll be using my Unity Catalog cluster for this section. I'll be using the Unity Catalog cluster for this section. So it's actually running right now. The reason why I made it running because of Databricks takes time to start your cluster. To start a cluster, it takes time. So I'd rather just let it be running. Even though it's going to cost me a lot of money, let me just let it be running. So what I'm going to do now is I've sent everyone a file. I can see this message. Okay. So I've sent everyone a file, right? I've sent everyone a file that, okay, that file it has is like a notepad. So if I go to my workspace, if I open my workspace, if I go to my Databricks, if I go to my personal projects, so webinar. So I've created a notebook for our webinar. So the one of the beautiful things about Databricks is that it gives you this whole kind of feeling like you are on, what they call it, like you're on a Jupyter notebook. You get, it gives you this whole experience of a Jupyter notebook that, oh, I'm actually working on a Jupyter notebook. So it gives you that kind of feeling. So if you're someone that's very comfortable with writing Python code, then Databricks is awesome for you. But if you prefer more of a GUI interface, then it can actually work best for you. So now the first thing I want to do now is I have three data, right? I have a sales data, I have the sales target, and also have the branch data. So all those three data are inside of my storage system on Azure. So if I put my Data Explorer over here, so I have three containers, right? With my three containers, I have the bronze container, I have the silver container, and I have the gold container. I was actually meant to do a very detailed architecture for everyone, but because of time and everything, so there was not much time. So I was meant to create a very detailed architecture for everyone. So now for this, thanks in messages. Okay, awesome. Okay, so for this, I have three containers, the bronze, the silver, and the gold. So let me explain how these three containers work, right? So for the bronze container, right, it's more like you just dump all your files there. So you don't need to do your transformation. So the idea for bronze container is that you take all your raw files, you just dump it on your bronze container. Like you don't even need to know, oh, this file, this is what it's meant for, this file, this is what it's meant for. Just take your file, dump it in the bronze container, right? So that's why I call this my bronze unity catalog, right? So when you have dumped all your data in your bronze container, right? The next one is my silver container. So you can call it your silver table also. The idea for your silver table is that silver table are usually your structured data. So the data that I've done my transformation on, I've cleaned it, I've standardized the entire data, I push it then to my silver table. That's the whole idea of silver table, right? So the transform, the clean data are usually put inside your silver table, or your, you can call it your silver container when you prefer. So, but I'll be using Unity Catalog and Delta tables. So the silver tables are usually your cleaned and your transformed tables, they're your standardized tables. While the last one is your gold table. So the idea for the gold table is more like, this is where you do your presentation. So for me now, as data engineers, right, you don't want people to connect directly to your silver table. Rather, if I have a data, because the whole system of data, right, is between the data engineers, data analysts, and data scientists, right? So as the data engineer, I've created a bronze table, which I put my raw data. I've created a silver table, which I put my transformed data. Then I now have a gold table. So the gold table is where I let my data analysts and data scientists connect to, so they can do all the analysis, all the prediction, and all the model. I don't want them to connect directly to my what? To my silver table. So now if you look at my data explorer, yeah, my Azure Data Explorer, I have three different tables, which is the branch data, sales data, and sales data. Targets. What I'm going to do now is these three data, I'm going to transform it, I'm going to standardize it, and I'm going to push it to my silver table inside of Databricks. So if I go to my Databricks now, right? So the first thing you need to do, you have to check for your mount points. So this one, very important thing, you have to check for mount point. Let me close this one. I don't know why it's opening. So I have to check for mount points, right? So if I run this code here, right? So this code shows me all the mount points. So this code just means Databricks utility, right, shows me all the mount points available. So you can see I have different mount points on my Databricks. So this is my mount point, just showing me all my storage accounts that I've created a mount point for. So the first thing I'll do now, let's now read our sales data. So I'll first do for sales data, first of all. So let me just clean this one. It's not meant to be sales target. So the first name is called a sales data. So I'll change it to sales data, right? So now, how do you read data? It, for some of you that are used to Fabrics or Synapse, it's still the same thing with Databricks. So anyone works well for everyone. So now the first thing I want to do now is I want to read my data. If you are using Python, you say pandas.read_csv. It's the same thing too with Spark. You say what? Spark.read.csv. And I put my mount point. So this is my mount point. If I come here now, you see this is the mount point. So this one over here is the mount point. So this is the mount point that is connected to my Unity catalog, my bronze container. Remember, I showed you what they call bronze container. This one here, this is the name, bronze Unity catalog. So I'm actually mounting it now to my Databricks itself. So the first one is what I will say, what sales_df spark.read.csv, right? And I use what they call header equals to true. So header equals to true means it makes every first row the first header. So if you're used to things like Power Query and you're importing CSV file, you know that it wants you to make first row as an header. So what I'm doing, you're making first row as an header, and I use the infastick schema, which it picks all the right schema for me. So if I run this by pressing shift enter, right, so it's going to be running the cluster. Let me check, I'm seeing some notification. Is there any message? And Michael, I'm still audible like this.
Yeah, don't worry. So, I'll notify you if anything, but all is good.
Okay. Yeah, because I'm using my phone internet. Okay. So the idea for this now, so I've already read the sales data, right? So one thing I used to do is I used to check the data type. So if we click on this drop down, it gives you all the different data types, right? So I have the transactional ID, I have the date ID, I have the branch. Because see, it's giving me the data type. This was an integer, it's a timestamp, string, and so on and so forth. The double means it's a decimal, right? But the thing is that, for we data engineers or data practitioners, right, one thing we like to do is we like to standardize each data type, because in a situation where this one now is an integer, because we're actually doing like a batch process, right? This is an integer. What about in a situation when someone brings another data the next day and it makes this a string? It's going to give us an issue. So the best thing we advise people to do is actually create a schema for each of the data types. So What I'm going to do now is I'm going to import what they call, say, import PySpark SQL type. So I'm going to import the different kinds of data type, from type to field to integer, string, date time, timestamp, and so on and so forth, right? So if I run this, it's going to import the different data type for me. So now to create like a schema for the sales data itself. So for the sales data now, I say structure type, right? I say, okay, for the transactional ID, make it an integer, right? For the date, make it a timestamp. So what I'm trying to do, I'm just trying to like create like a validation for this, that okay, whenever any new data enters, it's going to be exactly this format. Even if the person that is giving me the data change the type, it's still going to be exactly the same format. So this one just saves you stress, because of most times when you're getting data from two different kind of data types, you tend to get errors. So now when you do this, you run this, right? So the idea for this, they just give me a data validation for me. Okay, now, so I will now read the data again. Now I'll ask, okay, this is now my sales bronze equals to spark.read and a schema. Now, because I've already put a schema inside it. So this schema is this one here. This is my sales schema here. So I say, okay, schema open brackets, sales underscore schema, then read the data from this same data file. Okay, so it should be sales data. So I'll just change it. Sorry. Sales data. So I'll say this is my sales data. Right, sales data add, so on and so forth. Okay, so I'll run this, right? So, and if I click, that's everything is okay, right? Now let's go on. So let's now do some little bit of changing of column names. If you notice, the first column is transactional ID. So when, because the problem with this now is that if I'm running this on my SQL, that's SQL, right? Most of the time when you start having space in your column names, you tend to have issues with SQL. So what I did now is I changed all the column header name. So I said, okay, transaction space ID, change it to transaction ID. So I just basically just standardize the entire data, the ones I know that, okay, they need changing and the rest. So if I run this, I'm just basically changing all the columns name, right? So let's now see all the columns now by pressing sales underscore bronze dot columns. So this is going to show me all the columns, okay? So you can see dates. That is now unit price, unit underscore price. It's now sales underscore discount. It's now total sales. So I just basically like change the old column to make it make more sense, right? So another thing again for data professionals is because I'm going to be ingesting data from different sources, I'm going to put it in a data warehouse or a database system or something, right? You have to always have the exact time you ingested the data. This is just for tracking purpose. You want to like do like auditing and stuff like that. So that's what I tend to do most times. So what I'm going to do now is I'll import a library that gives me the exact time. So this is called current timestamp, right? So if I run this, and I'm going to add the current timestamp now to my bronze, table, which is sales underscore bronze here. So if I run this also, right, what it's going to do now, let me just show you. So I say display underscore bronze here. So why this one? Okay, now, if you look at this now very well now, you can see this is my transaction ID. All the informations are still the same, but now I've added a new column to this, which is called what? Ingestion date time. So this one gives me the exact time I ingested the data, both the date and the time. So this is just for security purpose, or maybe so let's say for instance now, you're trying to like backtrack or fast track or go back before time. So now if I keep scrolling, so now when I'm done with all the transformation, right, I've cleaned all the data, I've standardized the entire data, I've done everything I want to do. The next thing is for me to now push the data inside of what? A database, right? So the one I'm using what they call Unity Catalog, right? So there's something called the old Unity Catalog. It's more like, so if I go, let me just click on my data here. So this is my data here, right? Right, okay, awesome. So we have something called the Hive Meta Store. We have something called the Unity Catalog. So let's just check. Let me just check Bard first. Let me show you something. So if I open Bard, so that's just Twitter. So let me change this. I use more of my. Okay. So now, if you open Bard, what is the difference between the Unity Catalog and Hive Meta Store in Databricks. So the thing is that Unity Catalog just came out recently, right? It came out last year. If I check ChatGPT, I won't see it because ChatGPT is actually limited in terms of information, but I think Bard tends to get all the information, right? So Unity Catalog just came out. So it's more like Hive Meta Store, but Hive Meta Store is kind of old, I won't call it old school, but it's what we've been using forever. So you look at what Bart says, said that this is a newer, more powerful service than iMetaStone. It supports a wider range of features, such as support for multiple data sources, including Ive, Spark SQL, Delta Lake, and others. It's also a fine-grained control. It also allows audit logging. So the idea for audit logging is that I can actually backtrack, or I can time travel. Let's say, for instance, now I'm putting data in a data warehouse, right, on a daily basis, and all of a sudden I make a mistake, and I put the wrong data inside the database, I put data twice. So what this thing now, the audit log, means is that I can actually time travel. That means I can restore a data to a particular version. Again, it also provides what they call lineage tracking. So if you are using the Power BI data line, you also have the same feature in the Unity catalog. It also does the data quality check and everything. So it has so many features. Likewise, too, with the Ive MetaStore. So Ive is also limited, but the thing is that if you're looking for standard catalog, then use Ive MetaStore. But if you're looking for something more dynamic, something more innovative, something new, something fresh, then use Unity Catalog. But both works perfectly well, but I tend to use more of Unity Catalog. And to create a Unity Catalog might look a little bit complex, so I didn't want to do it now. So what I'm going to do now is, after I've transformed and cleaned all the data, right, the next step is for me to now push the data inside of a data base, right? So now if I open this is my Unity Catalog here, right? So I have my bronze table, I have my silver. So the idea now is that I will push all my transformed data into my silver table. All the standardized data should go to my silver table, right? So this is how you do it. You say write dot format dot delta. So why I'm using delta is that the beautiful thing about delta is that you remember that the file itself is a CSV file, right? The file is a CSV file, that comma separated value. So when I read it as a delta format, it converts it to Parquet files. So Parquets are more of column kind of data, that columnar data, and it's actually lighter than a CSV file. I'll show what I mean by this. So if I change it, if I say sales.write.format delta option, and okay, the mode now, I'll use override. Right. So if there's any data existing before, it's going to override it. And I'm going to save it as a table. So saving as a table means I'm saving it as a managed table. So you have two types of table. You have an external table, you have a managed table. So I'm going to save it as a managed table, right? So, and for Unity Catalog, it has three naming conventions. So the first naming convention now is the catalog name, which is what Unity Catalog Project. The second naming convention is the database. So for database in Unity Catalog, we call it a schema. It's called a schema, right? So, and lastly now is the table name. So the table name I want to create is going to be called processed sales. So if I run this now, let's see. It's going to take a couple of minutes. It's running. Okay. So it's running the job. Now for some of you that may ask, I'm actually using a single node cluster, not a multiple node, because of I want to save cost and everything. And this is not a big data, so I can run with a single node. So if I expand this, it shows me all the jobs that was done, right? So now I've actually created the table in my silver database. So if I refresh this here, you can see now process is showing. So what I can do now, let's now do some little bit of query to see the data itself. What I will do now, and one beautiful thing about the Databricks notebook is that I can actually interswitch between Python, SQL, R, Scala, and some other language. Let's say I want to write some SQL now. I'll say, I want to use this catalog and this Databricks over here, right? Okay, so say SQL, say select. I just want to see the data first of all. I know if the data actually copied correctly. Okay, so if I run this, let's see. Okay, awesome. So no issues, right? So let me count how many columns are there, how many rows rather. So I'll count how many rows are here. So I'll just change this here to count. So just count how many rows. So if I run this, okay, now so I have 999 number of rows. Okay, so now I've done for the sales data. I'll do the same thing also too for the sales target itself. So So on all this time, it's still the same process I did. So this one should be sales target, right? This should be sales target. I hope I got the spelling right. Let me check my data break. So this sales target. Okay, awesome. The same thing too. I'll run this to check the schema itself. Okay, this one doesn't really have much column. I have the year as an integer, the date, string, branch, product, and sales double, right? So let's check all the columns itself. So the same thing I said the other time, so I have to standardize the entire data types. That means I have to create like a data validation, right? I don't want to use the default from Spark because you tend to have errors when you're appending. So what I will do now is I will run this to import the different libraries, and I will change, I'll set the different schema for the target schema itself. So I will run this also. Okay, so now let's now read this now. So I'll just change this and just copy this here. So this is my sales data targets. Remember, there are three tables. I have my sales data, I have my sales target, and also have my what, my branch table. So this is my sales data targets, right? I don't need to put, if you look at it, I don't need to put this infra schema true because we have already set the schema already. So that infra schema true means it Spark just gives you the schema that it thinks is best for it. But now I've already set my schema myself with this target schema over here. I just need to just run this. And okay, voila, it's worked fine. Let's just check it now. If I say display target bronze, remember my raw data are my bronze table, right? So this is to bronze table itself, right? So if I run this, okay, so everything is fine. Awesome. Now the same thing to put the ingestion time, right? The time you ingested the data itself. So what I'll do now is run that Spark current timestamp. I'll add the timestamp to the data itself now, right? Okay, so awesome. So now I can see the ingestion date time is now showing itself, right? Cool. So the same thing I did also too. I will now write this also now to my silver table. So I'll say my target bronze dot write delta. I'll tell you the advantage of I'm using delta. So delta option, this one should be override. So I'll use override for this. Override. All right. So the name now is Unity Catalog Silver Process Target. Awesome. So if I run this, I should have it somewhere here. Okay, awesome. So run. So if I refresh this, now I can see now. And also you can use Unity Catalog as your data warehouse also. I think that was also Databricks are actually pushing for right now. They don't want people to use the conventional data warehouse. So it's actually faster that way. Now let's just say, let's just check if everything copied successfully. So I'll use a SQL here. Yeah, I'll say select all from. Well, I think I'll do data visualization also before we push to Power BI also and everything. So let's just check if it runs successfully well. Okay, awesome. So it's, now I'm reading the data now from the table itself now. So I can just count this and see. Counts all. Does it count? Just total row target, right? Targets. Okay. TAR targets, right? Okay. Okay, yeah. So this worked fine. So I'll do the last one. The last one won't really take much of my time. So I'll do for branch also. So if I run this, if I run the branch. Okay, awesome. So the branch, I'm really waste more time because branch is just the way it is. So I'll just say the ingestion time. I'll run this and I'll run this. I won't really waste most time for the branch. Because the branch is just once all through, but the rest they'll keep coming on a daily basis. Okay, cool. So if I refresh this, I should have the three tables here. Awesome. So I have my process branch, process sales, process target, right? So let me show you something about the advantage where I'm using more of the Unity catalog and everything. So if I go to my data over here, right? If I click on data, right? So if I open my Unity catalog, if I click on my silver table itself, right? So if I select my sales here, so you can see this is actually a delta table, right? And you can see that the size here now, for that sales data, the size here is 5.4 MB, but the original size, if I go to my my Data Explorer, that which is my blob storage. If you check my sales data, you can see the size it was 83.11 MB. I can see that it has dropped drastically now toward 5.4, right? So that's one of the advantage of saving your data in packet files. So now this just shows me all the columns. I can actually do more investigation about the data itself. So this shows me all the columns here, right? If I click on the sample data, it just gives me like a preview of the entire data itself. So if I scroll left to right, you can see, right? If I check the details, okay, these are the details of the data, right? And you can see that it's actually a what? It's a managed, I see it's a managed table. So there are two types of table you can create. You can either create a managed table or you can create a external table. So this is a managed table over here. I can see the type is a Delta table. You can also grant permission to people in your organization, right? So you can give them the modifying permission, the select or the all privilege. So for history is more like I'm trying to like track, like time travel. So you can see that I have only one version here. That's version one. You can see. So the version one is just to create. If I check the activity that was done, this is the version one. You can see the timestamp, the ID. I only created. Yeah, I did create and replace. So that's the version one. But I will still keep on putting more data in that table. So it's more like it's called incremental load, right? I'll keep putting more data inside of the table. If you check the lineage also, so lineage just is the same experience as data lineage in your Power BI or any other tools. And if I check insights, okay, so this is fine. Okay, so this is fine. So what I'm going to do now is let's now do a little bit of SQL. Let's now create like a report from this. So I'll open my workspace again. I'll go to where that file was. So that's my Databricks personal projects webinar. So this is my webinar. So I'll create a new notebook, right? So I'm going to create a new notebook. So this one should be Python. So I'll just create some data visualization and analysis itself, right? Okay. So let's now do some analysis itself. But before I start any analysis, there's something I have to do. Remember, I have my bronze table. I have my silver table, which, remember, my silver table is my transformed data. So I have to have gold. My gold is not in there. I remembered I want the data analyst to connect, or the data scientist, when they want to connect to my data warehouse. I don't want them to connect to the silver table, because if you worked in all these fintech companies, if you ever connect to the database, they're always like, the software guys are always going to like, they'll feel like strangling you. So one thing they tend to do is that they create a view. So a view is actually called a virtual table itself. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to create a view for my, what do you call it, for my gold table. So all my data, so everything in this, my silver, I'll copy it also to my gold, but to be as a view. So I won't consume much space. So what I'm going to do now is I'll say, let's start, say use catalog, right? So use catalog. Okay, so if I run this, so that's the schema I want to use now. Let's go to the base. Okay. Oh, okay, no problem. Let's just start first. Let's say, I don't know why that is bringing out that out, but let's, don't worry. So I'll say create view. The name of the view, I should give it I'll say sales underscore view, right? But that will put the catalog name. So I'll say the Unity catalog dot, I want to put it in the gold table itself, right? So create view from the Unity. So the view is going to go to the Unity catalog, the gold table. I want to say as what I want to select all from what, that's the silver table itself. So I'll say the Unity catalog. Just copy this. So I'll say this one should be silver dot silver. But this one here should be called processed sales. Should be called processed sales itself. Okay. So what I'm just trying to do now is, I am trying to create a view. Okay, I'll explain that. So create view. Let's pray this works. No issues. Can't see the font. I'm coming. It's strange. See, use Yes. Dot silver. Okay. This worked, so let me try this again. Page views. That's strange. Just sorry, give me a minute. I don't know why. I actually did this earlier today. Why is it now not working?
It's
Oh, okay.
if,
Process,
yeah,
process, processed. Oh, yeah,
P is
just wait
missing.
now. Yeah, thank you. Okay. Oh, awesome. Okay. So what I'm just trying to do now is I'm trying to create a view table. So if I refresh this now, right? Yeah, you can see I have a view table over here now. So I've created a view called Unity Catalog from this. So I'll do the same thing now. So the idea now is that for the analyst or for the scientists, they will not connect to my silver table. They will connect to the gold table. So the gold table is more like my presentation table. So this is where they connect to. So the idea now is that if I keep populating, if I keep transforming data and putting the data in my silver table, it's also automatically going to reflect in my gold table also. Okay. So I think I've explained it already. So I'll just do it again for the rest of them. So if I copy this also, paste this here. So this one now should be target view. Target view. This one should be process target. Process target, right? Okay. This thing shows me error most time. Okay, cool. Lastly, I'll copy this one also, the last one. And this one should be branch view. Branch view. This one should be branch here. Yeah. So this should be branch here. Yes, H branch. So I think this should work. Okay, so let me refresh this and check again. Okay, yeah. So I have everything. So I can just clear this. So I'll not affect the whole thing itself. Okay, so let's say I want to use gold table itself now. So this one just basically means we want to set the gold database, or a gold database, right? But Databricks itself should be calling a schema, so gold schema. So I don't know why they said that schema. So I'll set the gold schema as my default, right? As my default. So if I run this, so this is going to be my default, right? Okay, cool. So let's now start doing our analysis from here. So let's say I want to see the branch against total sales, right? So if I say, let us say the first one says the branch versus the total sales. So the beautiful thing about this is that even as a data engineer, you still have to know how to do data analysis to an extent. So the idea now is that I know the data analyst will still connect to the database, the data warehouse, right, and do that reporting either on Tableau or on Power BI and the rest, so on and so forth. But as also a data engineer, you also have to have your own report on your Databricks system, so you can just use that to like always monitor that. Okay, whatever the analyst is getting, you too you should also be getting the same results itself. So what I'm going to do now, I'll say select. I need a branch. I need branch. I also need what the total sales. What's the name of the total sales? Yeah. So that's sales view, total amount sold, right? Total amount sold. I'll say the sum of the total amount sold as total sales. I'm just giving it an alias. Say from, I'll say from all the sales view from the sales view table. So let's say select branch area. Select branch. So should be sum of total amount sold. Okay. Let's see. Okay, let's try something. Let me join for them to try a join. I'm coming. See this one work. Let's say select B form. Oh, I was meant to do an aggregate. See me. I didn't do a group, but I don't mind. Select Kenya. This one will be s dot. This one will be s dot total amount sold. I was meant to do a group by. From as total sales from, I'll say from the branch table view. So that's from the branch table view. This one doesn't really mean sure as B inner join. But to join, I'll do inner join with the sales view. Those view as S on what now? On the branch. The branch data equals to S dot branch. I say group by. Say group by. I'll do aggregate by one. By say two in descending order. Now let's create box. Inner join you. That's one end. Okay. So this worked, right? Okay, so I have the different branch against the total sales, right? So I can do like a visualization from this. Let's just want to create like a chart from this now. Let me change this. Let me make the color green. Okay. So this works fine. Okay, that's cool. So save this, right? Okay, let's do another visualization. Now let's want to get. Oh, sorry about that. I think my neighbor's kids are playing. Let's want to get now products versus amounts. I was meant to do a group, but I didn't know I didn't do the group by the other time. All right, so it says select. Product, right? So what's the product from this one now? The product name is this one over here. Products versus the total amount sold. Total amount sold. So I can just sum this total amount from the sales underscore view. So group by one. Let's run this, okay. Sales view, okay, cool. So I can plus get the amount visualization from this, make the color green. Right, I think this is okay. Okay. Which other one do I want to do? Okay, let's just check for the what do you call it now? Let's group for the time zone now. What I mean by time zone, you know, we have different time zone, like so I want to group it based on morning, afternoon, and evening, right? So what I can do now, I can say select all, right? So if you are trying to group, like you're doing like an if statement in the SQL, it's called the case when clause, right? So I can say the case, no, not call this case. I don't know why it keeps bringing case. Okay. The case when. So when hour now, I think I should have hour here. When hour is less than 12, then it should return for me. Then it should return morning for me, right? Say when that same hour is less than 16. So I'm not trying to group between morning, afternoon, and evening. It's less than 16. Then it should return what for me? It should return afternoon, right? And else, that's else if, like the else statement. Else, every other thing should be what? Evening, right? So you have to end as, you have to give that, you say end as what now? I'll call it time frame. It's easier that way. Time frame. time frame. Okay, so if I run this, but I'm trying to do like a nested subquery now. Let me just see if this will work. So this is going to be like my new table, this one here. So let's see if I say select my time frame. Let me just see columns. I'll say select time frame from here. Select time frame. Select the sum of the total amount sold. Where's my total amount sold? So it'll be easier that way to get everything. Total amount sold as total sales. I'll now say from, open my brackets here. So I'll cut all of this now. Cut this, put it inside. Just like you call it nested subqueries, right? And as this, I hope I don't make mistake in this thing now. Frame. Okay. Wait. So give me a minute. I don't want to make mistake in this thing. But let me just test it first of all. I put this here. And this from sales view. Let me put my sales view here. Let me test it. See if it's going to work fine. So, oh, see me. So the idea of this now. Okay, I'm also trying to create a new column here. Let me run this. Let's see if it works. This should work. Okay, so this worked, right? So now let me copy this and I'll put it inside here now. Right? So now I'm saying what? Select time frame. That's this time frame I created and the total amount sold. You know, I have total amount sold. Yeah. Because I created like a nested subquery, right? And I'll give it an alias name as time frame table. When I say group by, because I have to do an aggregate group by one, which is my time frame. I think it's pretty works. Everyone is okay. Awesome, it ran. Okay, so what I was just trying to do, I was trying to break everything down for evening, after. So the, I don't know the amount of sales you meet for the individual date of the time, right? So I'll say visualization. Yes, you know, I just like using the green theme. It looks cleaner that way. Say save. Okay. Okay, so let's now create like a card, right? Like we have like a card visual now. Let's see. Create card visuals. Visuals. So I will say select. I will say sum of the total. Like total amount sold, sum of the total amount sold from what now? From the sales view. The sales view. I'll give someone an alias as total sales. So. Okay, so I'll change this one to a card. You know what they call card? Card as single. Visual, so I'll change this to the type I want. So I'll look for a counter. Awesome. So I'll do one more for the targets. I'll get my total target, right? So say get total targets. So say select the sum of the first target now. So let's go to target table now. So say my target table should be something called sales here. Okay, awesome. Say sales as total targets from target view. Target view. Target view. I want to draw a map, right? Okay, so let me just, I have less than 10 minutes. So just see how long I can go. So let's do the last one. So let's say map now. Map visual. So say for my map, I'll select sales b dot longitude. So I'll use the branch table now. So I have longitude, latitude. So this branch, say longitude, comma b dot latitude, comma b dot branch. Dot branch, comma, and I'll say the sum of the total amount sold. Where's my sales view? Total amount sold. That's total from what now? Say my branch view. Where's my branch view? From the branch view as B. Inner join my sales view. No, it gave me a catalog this time. Let me just copy my sales view, but it's actually correct. Well, I don't like it becoming too long. Sales view, my sales view as S, right? So this one should be S, that's S dots, right? And I say on, so I'm joining on what? Branch of branch must be equals to sales.branch also. And I'll group by. So I'll group by three values now. That's 1, 2, 3. I think this should work fine. Okay, so it worked. So let's just create like this will be our last visual. I don't want to waste much time again. So I'll create a map from this now. Okay, cool. So now my latitude should be latitude here. My longitude should be longitude here. My group by should be branch. And if I, you can see, right? Okay, awesome. So I can just save this, right? So now let's now create our dashboard from this. Now we can actually create a dashboard from this. So if I click on this drop down, I see add dashboard, I see new dashboard, right? So I can give the dashboard webinar presentation, right? Okay, so let me go back to that visual again. So I've added this to my dashboard. I'll add this also to my dashboard. Add to this dashboard. Say add to my dashboard. Just keep scrolling down. Add to my dashboard. If I keep scrolling down. Add to my dashboard. Keep scrolling down. Add to my dashboard. I think, yep, awesome. I think that should all. So, okay, cool. I can now rearrange everything the way I want to arrange it. Just the same feeling you have in your Power BI and the rest. So it gives you the same kind of feeling. So if I put this one here, it's my feel like, let me just make this one bigger. I'll put it beside it. Okay, so now I can also say present. So it gives me this kind of view again. So now that's not even the main goal. So now I've already, you can see that I've transformed the entire data, I've cleaned it, I've done everything, right? So what I want to do next now is, if I do not connect, I think I made this my screen too big. Okay, so what I want to do now is, I want to connect my Power BI now to my data warehouse, right? So it's actually a catalog, also quite a data warehouse. So I'll go to my SQL, you see data warehouse here. So the advantage of this data warehouse is it gives you this kind of serverless compute, serverless endpoint. So that was one thing Synapse had over Databricks for a very long time, that it has this serverless endpoint. So you don't need to now start speeding up a new cluster every time, like it consumes much money and stuff like that. So now it has the same kind of feeling as your compute. So if I go to my SQL warehouse, if I click on create an SQL warehouse, I can actually create a warehouse from this, but let's not create it from here. So what I'll do now, I've actually created one already, which is called a serverless. That's my good analysis. This one here is actually, I can start it. But what I'll do now, I'll go to connections. So I have my host name, I have my HTTP parts and some other things. And you can see now, you can connect easily to Tableau, Power BI, DBT, Python, Java, Node, anything. What I'll just I'll open my Power BI. So now you can see that I've created a warehouse, a data warehouse from Databricks. I've done my transformation to my Silver. I've also pushed the same thing to my bronze table. So what I'll just do is get data. Let's create get data from here. But let me just cancel this. Let's see. Get data. Let's take it there. So I'll say Databricks. Databricks. So Azure Databricks connects. Okay. So it's asking me now for the server hostname. I'll go to my browser. I'll copy the hostname here. Paste this here. It's asking for HTTP path. Copy this here. Also paste it here. You can also put the catalog, which is the this thing's optional. You can also put the database, which is the schema, but also optional. You just click on OK, right? Let's wait a minute. Okay. So while this is running, let me check if there's any question in the chat box. Yeah, thanks.
There's one question that does this have to be a paid Azure subscription to be able to use the Azure Databricks?
Yes, it's part of the Azure listing subscription. So Databricks is also a resource, like it's part of the resources in Azure. So yes, thank you. So let's see, okay, awesome. So now I have all the this thing I need. I can just click on this Unity catalog. Yeah. But actually, this one, I think I skipped this step because I've already connected before. It was also meant to ask me for my personal code. So there's the personal code I was meant to generate because I've connected before. So it's not asking for it again. So if you want to get that personal code, right? You just go to your browser. You go to your users. That's your Databricks. You go to your user settings. From user settings, you can generate a new token. So you click on generate new token to generate a new token for you. But I think because I've connected before, it did not ask me to put my token again. So I'll go to my Go table. Okay, and I'll select the three views which I've already created, right? I just click on transform. So take me to the Power Query environment, right? Okay. Why this is running, let me just do some check-ins, some settings. So off, go to my data load, off auto detect relationship time, go to region. I'll use my language should be English Nigeria. So okay, I'm still with my Power Query. Okay, so I think all is good here, right? No issues. So I can just close and apply. Right, so that's not even what I'm aiming for. The idea now is after I've done this transformation, right? I'm still meant to be putting data batch by batch, but I don't think I'll be able to have time to do the Azure data factory parts because of time is not really, really on our side. So I have less than 1 minute more. So why this is loading, right? Okay, why this is loading? Okay, let us wait a minute, it's still loading. So if you have any question, you can drop in on the chat box or something. Okay. Oh, that's my care. Okay. I think it's still loading. Okay. So I'll wait. So why it's finished loading? The idea now is if I go to my my Azure Data Explorer, right? I need to upload new files because now I'm taking data by batch now. So I've gotten the sales data and the sales target and also the branch. That's let's assume that's for today's sales. What about tomorrow now? If tomorrow data comes to play, what will I do now? I'll just come here. I will put files, right? I'll look for the file. So I'll upload the sales target to sales. So this is like tomorrow's data that came in now. So both the sales and the target, right? I say open, upload this. So why this is uploading? It's gonna take a couple of minutes. Okay, awesome. So this has uploaded, right? So the idea now is this one is still loading. Okay, let's still leave some to be loading. So let me go back to my Azure. Michael, do I still have any extra time? I should just stop now.
No, you can.
Hello, Michael.
You can take a few more minutes. You can go
on. Okay, so The idea now is, if I go to my Databricks course, my personal projects, my webinar, the webinar transformation, right? So now another data has come in, right? So I'm actually meant to automate this entire process using Azure Data Factory, but it will take time for me to start spinning up and doing everything I want to do. So the idea now is, I've already done the transformation for the first one. So now tomorrow, now the next sales comes to play. I have to do what they call incremental load, right? So what I will do now is I'll just change this source. So this one now is called, it's called sales data, sales underscore data two. Okay. So I'll go to file, sorry, I'll go to edit, I'll look for find and replace, right? So any place I see sales data dot CSV, right? Replace with its sales underscore data underscore two dot CSV. I was actually meant to create like a variable and put this, but because of time and everything. So I'll just say replace all. So I've done for the first one. I'll do the same thing also for sales targets. And please, I see sales targets, right? Do target data two. Target data two. So let's check if it's target data two. Coming. Okay, yep. So I say replace all. Okay, awesome. Let's check if you replaced everything. Awesome. Okay. So now I can close this, right? Just close this. Okay. So what I'll just do now is, I was actually meant to create like a workflow around it. I was meant to show you how to use Databricks workflow. It's just like the old Azure Data Factory workflow. I think they just keep competing with one another, so technology keeps evolving. So I'll just click on run all to run everything for me. All right, so this will run everything for me. So why this is running? It's going to run everything for me. Oh, why did it fail? Why did it fail? Oh, I made a mistake. Actually, this was meant to be append. I was meant to append it, but I did. Oh, jeez. Okay, and no problem. So where's my Power BI, first of all? This was actually meant to, I was meant to append it, not even override, because I've already done the override the first time, so I'm meant to append. This was meant to be append. And, okay, I've append this one. I've done append for this one. No reason. Part's not found. That's the sales target. Sales target. It's called sales target. Sales target two. Just give me a sales target two. Okay. I've already made a mistake here, so I have to just do this part again. This one should be. Sales data, right? CSV. So if I run this, okay, run this. Was that sales? So this one now should be override. Override the first one. Okay, so it has override. So I'll now do it again now. So this one should be append now. I'll say append. So append is like you are appending, right? So this one, I'll change the name now to sales data. So it should also be sales data too. So I also just confirm if everything is correct before I run it. This append correct. I think this should be append also correct, right? Okay, so let's run or let's see. Let's hope we don't have any issue this time around. So Yeah, the beautiful thing about it is that you can easily switch from SQL to Python or something I showed again. Spark.read. File path not found. Why is this not being found? I'm coming. Sales target to oh, semi. Sales targets. So this should run. Okay. So let me just run everything manually. Well, okay. So that's the whole idea. And you can come here, and if you say update, it updates the entire data for you. So this is running, right? Let me check if it has connected to Power BI. And voila, you can see the Power BI one is already connected. So I think that's how, that's all. That's all. Let me don't go too far more further again. So I think that's all. So the whole idea is I get data from, I get raw data, right? I put it in my storage container, which is my Azure Data Factory. Oh, sorry, my Azure Data Lake, Jensen. So from there, I now mount it to my Databricks. I do my entire data transformation and I push it to where my Unity catalog, which serves as my data warehouse. So for my data warehouse, I also create a visualization from it, like a data visualization, right? So this is what this is. This one is for the data engineers, right? It's actually monitoring everything from the Databricks. So now for the data analyst, now is he or she is going to connect to the data warehouse view table, and he or she can now start doing their own analysis from their own Power BI. So you are expecting to have the same result. So whatever result, whatever visualization they create from here should also be the same thing with this. But what I was planning on doing with Azure Data Factory was to create like a trigger, like an event-based trigger that whenever you put a new data inside of the blob storage, it actually starts the entire workflow or the entire pipeline. So I think I'll stop here. So Michael, I think I'm done. Okay. I'll stop sharing my screen.
Right. So thank you. Someone was asking a question that it was about the incremental load. Can it be scheduled from a source to destination instead of doing
yes.
manual? I think you mentioned yes. that the data factory.
Okay, the idea was to use actually there are two ways. Now you can actually use for the incremental load, you can actually use Azure Data Factory. That's you just create like a flow, like a pipeline for different activities, like pipeline. Or you can also use what they call this one now, the workflow. So there's something called the workflow that was got created for by Databricks. So if I go to workflow, if I say create a new job, so the advantage of workflow too is just like a job, right? So it's a one-time job, unlike the general purpose cluster. Where I can just say okay, data, let's say transformation, right? And I'll select this is the work notebook.
I hope workspace. You know your screen is not showing.
Jeez. Okay, sorry. Okay, let me start again. So, if you go to your Databricks, you can actually do rather than me doing it manually, you can actually automate it, right? So, you can use Azure Data Factory. That's what I was planning on doing, but because of time. Right, so you can use Azure Data Factory. So for that Azure Data Factory, you can set like a trigger. So a trigger can be in two ways. You can do an event-based trigger, or you can do a scheduled trigger. So for event-based triggers, it happens. So the event can be like, okay, whenever I upload a new document, like the way I uploaded this document the other time. So whenever I put a new document inside of this storage container, the trigger starts. Okay, so whenever a file is uploaded, just like I use the Power Automate, a trigger is basically what starts an action. So you can create a pipeline from that. So just automated, right? Or so Databricks also created theirs recently called the workflow. So if you go to workflow here, you can just go to create a new job, right? And the advantage of using Azure Data Factory or workflow is that it just runs a job cluster just once, not like a general purpose cluster. I can just see. Data transformation, right? And I can say the part, I'll select the part, which is my data breaks, personal projects, webinar, and data transformation here, right? Okay, cool. And I can create, okay, let's save it, let's say confirm. And I can add another step again. As another notebook, right? So like I'm creating like a different activity for different pipeline, right? I say so should not be my visualization, right? And I'll select the part again. Databricks, personal projects, webinar, data visualization, confirm, and you say great. So it has been created. So I've created two tags now that are connected to one another. So the idea now is that as soon as I click run, right, I can also set, you can see you can set schedule, you can also set triggers. You can set schedule, you can set trigger, you can also set notification that, okay, if your flow runs successful, send me a notification. If it fails, send me a notification. You can do so many other things. And that's also some of the beautiful thing about your Databricks ecosystem itself. This same thing is what you would have done, I would have done in Azure Data Factory. I would have created different pipeline with different activities, connect them, and I'll set a trigger. So it's the same thing too. Yeah. I also feel like Databricks are trying to let you just, the way we used to use it before was, I created a different notebook. I use Azure Data Factory to like run everything, automate everything. That's doing the whole incremental load, and also write a code to actually help me to change variables and everything, right? But now that Databricks now has workflow now, so you can actually create your own workflow now from inside of your Databricks. You don't need to now go into Azure Data Factory to create your workflow. So I think that should answer his question. So let's see. Any other question?
So I was going to ask, what about wildcards? So, though I know it won't work for the append, but instead of specifying a file, the exact, you know, like sales data, you now use wildcard, anything that is sales data, maybe star.csv, with that.
Okay. Work. Awesome. Yes. Awesome. So that is where Azure Data Factory has an edge. So for Azure Data Factory, I don't need to even put sales. I can just say, okay, if it ends with, or if it starts with, or if it contains, you get. So if I've done it in Azure Data Factory, I would have showed you like, okay, you know that the other one I created now, this, if you look at the files now, this one here has sales target 2. I can just say if it ends with csv.2_ target, or it doesn't necessarily need to have the sales in it. I can say if it ends with a certain amount, a certain number of values, or if it starts with a certain number of values, you get. So you can actually use that also to start the trigger itself. So whenever I upload a file and it ends with _2.csv, it starts the pipeline. I know that tomorrow now I'll put _3.csv. So I'll change it again. So it's funny that way, but I know that Data Factory can do that. When I'm starting my trigger, you can actually use wildcard. I can set some parameters to it, but I've not really tried the workflow for Databricks. I don't think that's those much functionality right now.
Okay. Thank you. Any questions from anybody else? I'm looking at the time, but it's been a good, well spent one. Anybody has any question? Lots of clap from people. Sure. People found this one valuable, new, get to expose to new set of tools. Okay, so without any question from anyone, I'll say thank you to everyone. You can connect with Temi that you have shared the link. Also, you can give us the feedback for today's session. I've shared the link, but sharing it again. If you have anybody you would like us to bring on the series as a speaker, you can give them this speaker form, you know, and if you also have something you want to present, you can fill the speaker form. So thank you to everyone, and have a wonderful weekend. Thank you to the wonderful demo, and just to share again, I know you shared the material, but just in case people join too late and you notice it, I'm resharing it so that they get to see it. So thank you to everyone. Have a wonderful weekend. Bye.
Goodbye. Okay,